Hello, my name is Svein Høgemo, and I will now present the work on hierarchical clusterings of unweighted graphs that I have done together with Christoph Paul and Jan Arne Telle. This work revolves around this cost function on hierarchical clusterings, which was introduced a few years ago by Dasgupta. And this measures the quality of the hierarchical clustering. It's the purpose of it, at least. Let's just see the definition first. Given the graph G and some clustering tree, which we can visualize as a tree, and the function delta that goes from the vertices of the graph to the leaves of the tree, we define the function as for each edge of the graph, we look at the size of the smallest subtree that includes both the vertices and the edge, and we sum together these sizes for all edges in the graph. This is for unweighted graphs. If we have a weighted graph, we just multiply it with the weight of the edge. The purpose is clear for graphs measuring similarity of a data set, points on a data set. We want to minimize this cost, and for graphs measuring the dissimilarity, we want to maximize this cost. Just an example here for this house graph, we make the clustering tree minimizing this cost, which is at the top here. It has cost 20 when you sum over all edges. And the tree at the bottom, it looks just the same, but the nodes are placed differently. And it has cost 28, which is the highest possible. In his paper where he introduced this measure, Dasgupta showed that finding a clustering optimizing this measure is NP-hard, which is hardly a surprise. He showed this by reducing from a problem he made himself called NASAT star, which is easily reducible from the well-known not all equal SAT. An instance of an NASAT star instance looks like this. Every variable appears in exactly one free clause, and in exactly two clauses, with one negative and one positive, and no two clauses contained in a three clause. And as a toy example, we'll just look at this smallest possible NASAT star instance, which has one three clause and three two clauses. To reduce to the hierarchical clustering problem, in which we want to maximize the cost, which we will also see later in this presentation, that this is what we focus on, maximizing the cost. From this example, we make a graph G, where for each three clause, we make two triangles, one for the clause and one for its opposite. And likewise, for each two clause, we make two single edges, like this, and for every pair of variables, x1, not x1, and so forth, we have a edge with a large weight, which is unspecified. Given an assignment, well, this graph here has not all equal satisfiable assignment, which is easy to see, but for an instance with an not all equal satisfiable assignment, we can make a clustering this way. First, we just split the graph into two halves, one for the true variables and one for the false variables. This ensures that nearly all edges are cut at the top. The only edges that are not cut are one for each triangle, but these we can easily split apart afterwards, since every triangle is disjoint. And the DC cost is then this. And it's easy to see that this must be the highest possible because of the matching edges. So the content of this presentation will largely spring forth from this simple question. How about the unweighted graphs? Because we want to investigate the properties of the hierarchical clusterings in light of this function, more purely graph theoretical, and then a natural starting point is unweighted graphs. So this this reduction naturally doesn't give a proof that it's NP hard to cluster unweighted graphs optimally, but that's we wanted to see if the same reduction can be applied to unweighted graphs. That was our first question, and then we look at the same reduction, but not giving a large weight to the matching edges only. So then the DC costs would be this above here, and to try to prove that this is the highest cost possible, and that there is no such clustering if there isn't a satisfiable assignment to the underlying formula, then we look at the graph that you get by taking away the two cross edges. So you have only triangles and matching edges. It's easy to see then that for any clustering of the original graph, the clustering of this graph must have crossed at least 48 times m squared, where m is the number of three clauses in the graph, which is m is equal to 1/3 of n, obviously. So what is this graph? Well, it's actually this graph, the prism, which is, well, it's two triangles with a matching in between these two. The prism has six vertices, nine edges, and it has a high degree of symmetry, which is its vertex transitive. And its highest possible DC cost is 48, which we get by splitting it apart in this way, just as we would do in an given an not all equal satisfiable assignment. The graph G prime is exactly M disjoint copies of this graph, the prism graph. And we want to prove that this 48 times M squared is the highest possible. So how can we do that? Well, first let's look at the graphs which have this property, that we call a graph max well-behaved if it has the property that the best way to cluster k disjoint copies of the graph is just to make the best possible clustering of one copy and then copy this clustering. And then you get the cost s times k squared for all k. And you can also do the same for the complement of the graph, then it's min well behaved. What's interesting is that not all graphs have this property. Many graphs do. We can look at bipartite graphs. They must, of course, be max well behaved because it's easy to maximize the cost on bipartite graphs. You just have all the edges at the top, split them apart, and the disjoint union of a bipartite graph is still bipartite. But not all graphs have this property. The smallest example I know of is this complete split graph with a clique of two vertices and an independent set of three vertices. And if you look at two copies of this, then the best way to split it is you flip one copy, and then the remaining edges get a little higher weight. So a natural question is to ask, is the prism max well behaved? That's what we wanted to find out, really. And it's not bipartite, so we can it's not trivial to find out by any means. So we had to come up with some other way of finding it. So R&D was to find just Okay, we have one clustering with this trust. It's easy to find. You just cluster one optimally, and then you copy this clustering. And then we wanted to show that, okay, we can find some way of modifying any clustering into this best clustering, and show that the DC cross never decreases when doing this. Then we can say that, okay, for any clustering, we cannot have a higher trust. And this is what we call the normalization procedure. It works in three steps. First, we do a top-down traversal of the tree, and perform the first step, which we call cut optimization, and the next step, which we call left heavy distribution, works in tandem with the third step, balancing, in a bottom-up traversal of the tree, clustering tree. And we start with some random clustering, and then we want to show that we can always modify it into this normal clustering without decreasing the cost, the overall cost. So the first steps, it is easiest to explain just in terms of the picture here. This is the one where we go top down. So we, for every node of the tree, we know that all the subgraphs in this node is split into two smaller subgraphs, and then we can look at the edges being cut there. And we see that, okay, the for every way of splitting, for example here, a subgraph with five vertices into a subgraph with three vertices and one with two vertices, then there are some ways to do that which are better than others. For example, in this where we split the house graph, which is a subgraph of the prism, you would rather do it in the way down to the right than in the way down to the left, because you get a higher trust. And you see that you can always modify the non-optimal splits into optimal splits in a way that doesn't affect the rest of the clustering, because these subgraphs are all disjoint. So just switching two vertices to obtain the best one is will always increase the trust. And after we've done with this, we see that all the subgraphs of prisms that are present in some subtree of the clustering tree is one of these types, only one for each number of nodes. And all the splits look like this. So this is the power of doing it top down, since when splitting a subgraph optimally, we get one of the other subgraphs. We know that when we come to a node, we have already done cut optimization on its parent, so we know all the subgraphs of one of these types. So when we have done with this, we can we know that all the subgraphs look like this, and we can move on to step two and three. Step two, which is called left heavy distribution, works like this. We look again at some node T of the clustering tree, and we know that if a subgraph is split with the biggest part on the right-hand side, we can easily turn it around so that it's split on the with the biggest part on the left-hand side instead. Why can we do this? Well, we do this procedure bottom-up, in tandem with the normalization procedure, or the balancing step. And this means that when we look at the children of this node T, CL and CR, we know that the subgraphs in these nodes are already fully normalized, which means that the subgraphs, which look like blobs down here, which are numbered, none of these have any edges. Therefore, we know that we can easily turn around each of these and get a clustering where each subgraph is split with the biggest part on the left-hand side. This reduces the number of possible subgraph distributions, can you say. So this will never decrease trust, it can only increase trust. So when we're done with this on the node, we do the last step, which is called balancing, and this is, we can say, is the is somewhat the easiest step conceptually. In this step, we just really do the naive thing and switch the vertices around until it looks like what we want, which is this very even clustering. Because in the lighter step, we know that the greatest part is on the left side, but we don't know if we split the prism into five vertices on one side and one on the other side, and we don't really want that. We want it to be split as evenly as possible. So we switch it around until it looks like we want to, and this is not that easy actually, because we want to keep all the properties of it being normalized. So we must be very careful with where we place all the vertices so that the edges are cut where we want them to. And then we have to show that the cost doesn't decrease, which is, it's not hard, but it's very tedious because we have to count the number of vertices in each subgraph, in each subtree, I mean. And afterwards, we have to multiply it with the number of subgraphs of each type, and then see that, okay, for each combination of subgraph, the cost doesn't decrease. Or, well, it does actually decrease in a couple of instances, but then we can argue that the cost actually increases more afterwards when we're doing it in a parent node, doing the same operation. So when we're done with all these three steps, then we get to this clustering that we now know is optimal, which means that no clustering of k copies of the prism can have across more than 48k squared, which is what we wanted to prove. So now we know that it's NP hard to cluster unweighted graphs as well. So it's just one result, but it's the techniques that we had to invent to show this, I think, is still worth presenting here. So what have we learned? We learned that hierarchical clustering is NP-hard, also on unweighted graphs, over this objective function. And we also know that it's not easy to prove things about these clusterings. What we don't know is there some easier way to see if a graph is Maxwell behaved than what I've shown you, because this is not a polynomial time procedure. It has to look at a significant number of all the subgraphs of a graph. So if we wanted to show some bigger graph being Maxwell behaved, we will see that it takes exponential time. And I don't think there is some easier way. I think it should not be easier than finding an optimal clustering in the first place. And secondly, are there some non-trivial graph classes that can be clustered? We know that bipartite graphs are easy to cluster, but we don't really know anything else. There are some results on graphs generated by an ultrametric, but these are mostly weighted. In the unweighted case, this just becomes a cluster graph, so it's not that interesting. We have looked into if the input graph is a tree, is it possible to minimize the trust then? And we don't really know. That's what I had to say. So thank you